season. All right, we're back with our discourse about work. Well, we had a great discussion during the break. And Deacon Flowers, you were making a point. You want to make your point?
Yes. I was just sharing with everyone that young people today, if they go out in the workforce in an entry level, if young people go out in the workforce in an entry level position, there's always people willing to help them along the way if they're willing to receive it.
Always people willing to help people along
right.
the way.
Yep.
If they're willing
if
to
they're
receive
willing
it.
To receive it.
Right.
You know, so if you don't know something, don't be afraid to ask a question.
Right.
That's how I got over it. Well, I got over it.
You were saying you had a young
Irish woman. Yeah, she helped me in American Express. In General County.
You worked at American Express
yes.
in General County?
Yes.
She told you you had to do this, right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And don't be afraid.
Told you
don't be afraid. Step up. You can do this.
Yeah, because when you do something new, you're always afraid.
Yes.
You're supposed to be afraid.
So take away the fear. And
yeah.
That's what
happened. Yeah. Take away the fear. Move through the fear.
Yes.
Move through the fear and move to mastery.
Right.
That's it.
There you
that's
go.
It. That's it.
It's been over 40 years now in accounting.
40 years.
Yeah.
In accounting. Yeah, God will send people to help you.
Yes.
All along the way.
Yes.
You know, you'll be surprised at what God does for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the old people say, if you make one step, God will take two.
That's right.
And we were also talking about how far we are from a day when your neighbors could whoop you, and your neighbors could spank you, and your neighbors would straighten you out. And we're in a day where people are scared to say anything to anybody. Because it's been proven that you can get jumped and beat down or hurt.
That's right.
So we're in a vastly different place than where we've been. And I don't know, the world of the future is going to demand new skills, but also some old skills. Discipline, leadership. Leadership is a skill. It's a skill that's developed. You're not born leading. Okay, even people who become great leaders, they're not born leading like that. They have to be trained and developed. And so we got to be trained and we got to develop our skill. And so that's what we're looking for people to do, okay? And do we have any questions? Do we have a comment?
Well, there is.
I thought people would be saying something about welfare.
Oh, yeah.
I thought that would be controversial. A lot of myths about welfare. You know, welfare is used by the rich whites to make poor whites think it's mostly black people in welfare. They don't know it's mostly white people.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the benefits go to white people. But the rich whites use that to keep the poor whites from uniting with black people and causing a change to the society. And this is something that one of the unfortunate things in our society, but that's how our society is.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is.
That's right.
Okay.
You know, Pastor, I was just sharing with Zianna that young people, if they're on a computer at home, they should also learn how to write a letter.
Young people should learn how to write a letter.
To do an email and get a response.
Yes.
And learn the different programs, not just the game. Excel is an accounting program. It's simple if you just take the time to learn it. While they're home under COVID, these are some of the things that they can pick up. So when they do go to a job, they can say, I do know how to use Word. I know how to do desktop. So these, they can take advantage of it.
Right, take advantage, you're saying, take advantage of your time at
right.
home.
Yes.
And learn Excel, learn
yes.
desktop.
Right.
You know, take a break, go outside, take a walk, you know, come back in and get to these new things.
Yes.
Right. Right. If it, one of the questions we should ask young people, what do you have to offer?
Mm-hmm.
What do you have to offer?
Well, I'm here.
No, that ain't everybody here. You gotta have more than I'm here. You know, can you do anything? You know, can you think? Even speech, can you talk? You know, I was in a funeral home and they were trying to get people to be quiet. I said, excuse me, can we have your attention? And then they said, oh. They said, we should hire you. I said, yep, start off by paying me some money for what I just did. But I learned how to do that. I learned how to do that. I learned how to do that from Larry Hawkins. I learned how to call the room to order. I remember when I worked in the United Methodist Church, Salem, I saw how orderly that church building were. Now, my own church being out, church being like, they had a brother or two. And I saw that they had some fights. And it was acting like Negroes, but it was all within Robert's Rules of Order. I said, hot dog, look at this. Organization. That's a big skill. And we want our young people to progress. And they're going to, again, they're going to live in a rougher world. Yes.
How do you know what you're supposed to do?
I think I'm going to take this to mean spiritually. Well, first of all, God puts a conviction in your heart. Conviction and convinced come from the same root word. When you have a conviction, it means that you are pretty sure of something. Okay? It means you're convinced. The word convict also means to tell somebody this is it, like they convict you for a crime. This is it, you're going to jail. So when you're convicted of something, you know this is it. And it's an inner knowing that comes from the Spirit of God, all right? And sometimes it takes time. When I was called to preach, it took time. Different things happened. One thing happened, I was deeply moved by a sermon I heard at my great uncle's funeral. The sermon just rocked me. It was only like 5 minutes. It really wasn't the sermon. It was just somebody giving comments at a funeral. But by the time he finished, the whole church was in an uproar and shouted for like 15 minutes. And I was jolted to my feet like electricity hit me. But I'm trying to think of the moment I knew I was called to preach. A lot of things happened. I had backslid and I was drinking, I was going to parties. And they nicknamed me the preacher. Because they said when I got a little drunk, I stopped talking about God. I said, nah, that ain't true. And they said, we're going to go back to this club we went to last week. And we're going to find somebody. And see if anybody's there. And we got to the club. We walked in the door. One of the girls said, "That go the preacher." I said, oh, Jesus. But a number of things happened. And I think a number of things happen to you when you realize through all of these things that God is trying to call you to something. A lot of times, do you remember when you were little and you were playing outside? You heard your mother say, Jeffrey, Jeffrey. But you were playing so much you sound back like out of here. And she said, Jeffrey, Jeffrey. Still stayed out there. And she said, Jeffrey, Jeffrey, you do. You better turn it around. So sometimes God calls multiple times. We act like we ain't heard. And you should see which way is God calling you. It's something that you know on the inside. Something that you could feel, something that you're aware of on the inside. You had this ability. I had the ability to speak powerful, strong from when I was a kid. I was in a contest and I was like throwing my hand. I don't know what I was talking about. And the people was mesmerized. When I got through, they jumped up. And I knew I had a gift to talk. People told me that. My Sunday school teacher said, you got the gift to gab. I think she's trying to tell me to shut up, but that's what she's told me. So sometimes people around you say, you know what, this is your gift. Sometimes people say, you know what, this is you. And then when you do that thing, you feel a connection to God and you feel a thrill in your soul that you don't feel anywhere else. And you get convicted, this is it. You get convinced, this is it. And you get a conviction, this is it. And remember what the Bible said, ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be open. Everyone that asks, receive, everyone that seek, find, everyone that knock, finds the door open. Ask the Lord, what is my gift? Seek for your gift, knock and say, this is it, the door will be open unto you. Any other questions?
Good
question. Now, when it comes to your secular work, most people have different jobs throughout their whole life. You have jobs alone, jobs where you're with people, and having experience in the work world will show you what you don't want to do, first of all. I had a job in a big grocery store chain in the Midwest called Jewel's. Y'all heard me say this all the time. I worked in a factory. My job was to put 1,500 boxes a night, take them off of the crate, put them on a sled that was hooked up to a pulley that was going all around the building. And you had to move fast. You had to do like this all night. They had a goal for you. And it was a Polish foreman that went around cursing everybody, you black so-and-so. First night they called me a black so-and-so, I jumped out. Men said, nah, they talk to everybody like that, don't. And I got so mad, and one man pulled me to the side, like you said. And he said, how much you make an hour? I said, like $18. He said, how many jobs you know you make $18 an hour? I said, not many. And he said, get your butt back in there, go to work. He said, I ain't gonna kill you, this dude called me name. I said, well, my father went cursing about it. He said, your father paid you $18 an hour? I still know he right. And I knew my father would have been keep this job. My, he got me a job in the post office, but I wasn't making that much. All right? And I would be so tired after 8 years of this. I mean, after 8 hours of this. See, I can't even get it right. After 8 hours, I would be so tired. I couldn't do nothing. I go home, I say hello. And I go to bed, and I wake up, shower, time to go to work again, because I had a long train ride. Then it was deep. My muscles got big. People was like, oh, you lift the weights. Nope, I'm going to work every day. But I decided I didn't want to be no jewel factory worker. And when I went back to school, I was like, oh boy, I'm going to study hard now, because I ain't doing that slave work with them Polish men cussing me out. I had another job. I worked in the post office with my father. He was on the upper floor. I was on the lower floor. They had me doing all kinds of stuff. It was a wonderful job. I got to drive a truck. I got to walk the neighborhood. I got to deliver special packages. I got to know the mailmen. There was a lot going on with them. All right, they had softball teams. They had card games when they supposed to be working. They had a lot of stuff. All right. Told me if I told them, they were going to find me in the back of some mail truck. So I was like, I ain't fucking nothing. Okay. I had a job once where I was a counselor. And I was counseling youth. I had another job for Larry Hawkins. I was a youth leader. These are all, I had a job for what we call Model Cities in Chicago. I don't know if y'all had it here. I was a landscaper. We were supposed to be landscapers. We were just picking up garbage. But it took us all over the South Side. And while I was on that job, I was in front of this big school, and the door opened, and this guy I knew, Susie Hyde, you heard me talk about her, one of my female mentors, her grandson came by. Couldn't miss him, because he's big, okay? And I walked over, I said, what you doing here? He said, I work here. And he said, what you doing here? I said, I'm with the summer crew. Over there. He said, come in and see the school. I was on my lunch hour. I came in, he showed me the school. I went to that school. I transferred from the school I was going to, went to that school. From that school, I got in a program at University of Chicago. From that program, I was able to get in any school in the country. God has a way of taking you places to show you different things. Like Deacon Flowers was talking about how he was at American Express, and that set him up the way he is now. A accountant at the United Nations, dealing with all kinds of countries and all kinds of people. God has a way of taking you through different jobs. One summer working with Larry Hawkins, I was a teacher. So I had all kinds of jobs. One summer when I was in seminary, I was a night watchman. I had to go around the whole building at night, and it was an old system. put a key in the thing and turn it, like little money, things like that. So the security company could see that everything was all right. I was in college and I was a computer coder, but I didn't work with a computer. I went to this big library and wrote these code things down and took them to my boss. And you know what? I think they just wanted to have a college school. And I was very quiet and meek on this job. Some of y'all can't believe that. But I was very quiet and meek, so they liked me. You know, I don't think they were comfortable with black people, but I was quiet and meek, and they didn't mess with me. And then it was a guy named Ken. Ken was very good to me. So it's good to have a lot of different jobs. It's good to work in a lot of different places, see a lot of things, learn a lot of things. And out of all of that, the Spirit of God moves you to show you which way you should go. All right? Any other questions? All right, let's have our list. We're going to maybe get out early. I'm so glad. Listen, I'm so happy people stay with us. Let me say one thing. Solomon said, "It's no greater joy in life than to work and to love your work." One of the ways you know about your job for God is you love it. You love it. Sometimes while you're doing it, it doesn't seem like work. Of course, there's some things about it you might not love. But while you're doing it, something in your soul says, this is it. And when I pray that everybody find that kind of work in life. And I pray that, as I said, we've been on this journey 30 years. Let's start helping other people get it. We got it. You know, my work here has been very fulfilling and fruitful. And I'm helping other people find the blessing in their work. So Deacon Lyons is here. Hazel Taylor is still here. Hey, Mama. I'm still rolling. Debbie Ann is here. Sister Kearney is here. Sister Moore is here. Christine Caraway, Sister Caraway is here. Sister Tucker, Rosa Wilkerson, Patricia Armand, Deacon Page, Vaughn Prince, Rosemary Perkins, Gigi Davis is here, Deidre White, Seth Edwards is here, Reverend McDonald is here, Deacon Brickhouse, Cheryl Kennedy, Joy White, Felicia Bernosh is still here. So, we want to thank you. If you didn't do the offering, please go to TCOTOD.org, go to the giving portal, give a Wednesday night Bible study offering, or go to TCOTODGIVIN on Cash App and bless the house of God. You can't be God giving. I was talking to the Lord today, and I was asking the Lord questions about some money because I got my heat bill. After I got the heat bill, I said, hallelujah. All right. Lord said, don't worry about a thing. I got it all covered. And later on, I was talking to somebody who was worried about money. And the Lord said, tell me what I told you. I said, don't worry about a thing. The Lord got it all covered. The Lord got it all covered for you. Don't worry about a thing. Keep your hand in God's hand. Seek God. Develop your hunger for God. Let God take care of the rest. Develop a hard-working mentality. Develop a mind that's ready to sacrifice. Develop the attitude of a soldier. The soldier wins battles. A farmer. The farmer conquers the earth and brings forth crops. And an athlete. Athlete wins the contest. Develop that mind and do your work. You'll find God always blesses you. Alright? Alright. Let's stop. Let's bow our head. God, we thank you for the overflow.
Yes.
Questions, answers, people studying. Lord, I pray that everyone who watched that you give them a special blessing. I pray that everyone who's with us tonight, your anointing would rest, rule, and abide with them. Lord, as we leave each other, never let us leave hearing and listening to you. Never let us leave working for you, Lord, because it was what Jesus did on the cross, his work of salvation that brought us to you. It is the work of the Holy Spirit in developing a hunger for God that keeps us with you. It's the work of the Spirit to heal our bodies and invigorate us. And God, we know that one day we're going to come home to be with you, and then we'll do divine work forever. This is our prayer. This is the thanks we give in the name above every name, mighty Master's name. name, the Lord Jesus, we pray for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, listen, we're going to head out. We are so happy that you were with us tonight. I want you to stay encouraged. The Bible said when the Lord closes the door, nobody can open it. When the Lord opens the door, no one can shut it. And that's why I love this prayer, because it's a season of the door being open for you. God bless you. See you on Sunday, God willing. Come and hear the word of God and be blessed. Keep praying. Keep fasting. Keep believing God. Don't let any momentary despair drown you. Don't let any negative feeling drown you. Don't drown in discouragement. Get the Bible and get some good news. We know how the story went. God wins in the end, and so do those of us who trust in him. Amen. All right, open door season. Door is open, and we're out.